Welcome to worship at First United Methodist Church in Worthington, Minnesota. Our worship service takes place every Sunday at 408 11th Street in downtown Worthington. We invite you to join with us. And now, here is today's message with Reverend Dr. Daren Flinck.
You paint the night. You count the stars and you call them by name. The skies proclaim God,
you reign. Well, my friends, good morning. Welcome to worship at First United Methodist Church. What a joy it is to be able to welcome all of you as we gather on in relative cool of the day inside. I understand it's pretty warm out there, but it's just a joy to be able to be here. Amen. Got a couple of announcements I want to share with you. First of all, we have something new that we're trying out. You'll notice that we don't have that connect card that you tear off from the bulletin anymore. Collective, oh, right? In truth, not many of you were regular participants in that. So what we're trying to do is just something a little different. We have a welcome connect card like this. Every pew has one, and if you feel that you want to fill that out, you can. You don't necessarily have to, but on the back side, if you have a prayer request or if you want to know more about some things, all you gotta do is make that and mark those down and then place it in the offering plate or send it to the church office. We'll be happy to do our best to get you connected. Okay, just a little bit different way of doing things. We'll try and see what happens. Right after worship today, I want to invite you to make sure that you're aware that we have the taco salad bar that's being sponsored by our missions team. And man, they got it ready going in there. It's going to be a fun time. So you don't have to worry about anything. You just come and fill up your plate and you're all good. All the proceeds for the taco salad bar will go to benefit the banquet, which is the next item on the announcement list. The banquet is scheduled for 2 weeks from tomorrow, and we do need to know if you're going to be signed up for that. Sometimes we wait until the last minute. It happens like that. I know I didn't sign up until yesterday morning, so it took me a while too. But if you can sign up sometime this week, that'd be fabulous, because Diane, our missions chair, needs to send that list in to the banquet so they have a general idea of what and who to expect. So if you're thinking about it and you come up to a decision on that, please sign up for the banquet and join with us as we go to that mission and ministry in Sioux Falls. Our Colossians study is actually going to be moved to 7 o'clock tonight. So I don't know if that's a better time for you or not, but we'd love to have you at 7 o'clock. It'd be great. We had a really great discussion last week. Those of you who were there, wasn't that a great discussion? I saw some heads nodding, but it was a good discussion. If you're interested, join with us tonight. And then finally, next week, we have our church conference on voting on our one church, three sites. And I appreciate your patience with this whole process. It's been a year since we started this conversation, and we've worked through a lot of challenging issues. We may not have all the answers at this point, but at least to a place where I think people can say we've got the information that we need to make our decision, whatever that decision may be. So we make that decision next week. That's 12 noon. We'll try to get going right about that time. We want to make sure that we honor where people are at. And I'm not sure if the exploratory team is going to have any kind of snacks or anything to hold you over. We haven't really talked about that, but you never know. We might have something that would be light and breezy just to kind of tide you over until lunch. I want to welcome some people who have just appeared out of nowhere. Well, actually, they live somewhere, but we're glad they're here today. Karen, bless your heart for coming back to your home church for many years. Grateful that you're here. Linda and Dennis have been traveling all over the United States and Canada. Yeah. Linda's Ralph Warner's daughter, and Ralph's been gone a little over 5 years now. Is that it? But we sure miss him, but we're glad that you have come back. And there may be others, if you're visiting with us, we're just glad that you're here today. Let's take the opportunity to move around the worship area as we greet one another with the peace of Christ. thirsty, come to the well and drink from waters flowing. You who are hungry, come to the bread and eat of his holiness. You who are tired, find rest. You who are weak, find strength. You who are thirsty, come to the well and drink. You who are thirsty, come to the well and drink from waters flowing. You who are hungry, come to the bread and eat of his holiness. You who are tired, find rest. You who are weak, find strength. You who are thirsty, come to the well and drink. He will freely feed all of them who are weak. He will quench the righteous thirst of all who humbly seek. Friends, join me as we turn to our call to worship. We gather as the people of God. God's message of love is ever before us. God calls us out of darkness and into the light. Let's join together as we sing number 2084 in the faith we sing. Come, let us with our Lord arise. Come, let us with our Lord arise, our Lord who made both earth and skies, who died to save the world he made, and rose triumphant from the dead. He rose the Prince of Life and Peace, and stamped the day forever his. This is the day the Lord has made, that all may see his love displayed, his feel his resurrection's power, and rise again to fall no more. In perfect righteousness renewed and filled with all the life of God. Then let us render him his own, with solemn prayer approach his throne, in meekness hear the gospel word, and thanks his dying love record. Their joyful hearts and voices raise, and fill his courts with songs of praise. You know, friends, I just want to give you all the praise and glory right here, right now, for this moment. You sang a song that had the 9-4 time amazingly. Praise God for that. 9-4 time. That doesn't happen every Sunday, and probably never will again. Let's join together as we share our prayer. With one voice, we pray these words. Holy One, we gather as your people giving thanks that we can be together to hear your word, offer our prayers, and sing your praises. Draw us together in your love, that we may know you more deeply. Open our hearts to a deeper understanding of your will, and work within our lives that we may produce the fruit of compassion. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. Let me invite the young Christians to come forward for the surprise box this morning. Well, good morning. What do you know? Short conversation, huh? Okay. All right, I'll tell you what. I got a couple of things in here. These are just the cream of the crop when it comes to tools. They're made by Stanley, all right? And I understand that they're good, and they're easy to spot in the store because all Stanley tools are yellow and black. Get it? All right, you know what this is, right? What is it called? A level, excellent. And what do we use this for? Leveling things. Yes, it's correct, that's what we do. What we do is we try to, wow, take a look at that. If you're building something, like for example, if you're building a wall in your house, putting in a new wall, you want to make sure you have a level so that you can get it straight, right? That makes sense. So this level does that. And not only does it this way, we can see that that's just a little bit off. That means that this end has to come just a hair that way. Not much, but just a hair. And then you can also do it this way, too. See that one down there? Just a little bit off. Okay. Now, that's one thing. This one, you know what? I haven't used this one, but there's a little level right here. This is a really cool thing because you can hang and level your pictures. And it's really, really the nicest little thing because here's what happens. You place your picture, you place this on the wall where you want it. And then you place your picture over it. And then you press these things in. And see these little nail things? I don't know that they're, well, they are kind of like, they're sharp, really sharp. You press those into the wall, and then that's where you put your holes for to hang your picture. Does that make sense? Yeah, I think it's really cool. And then it's level and everything. And I bought this, and I've not used it yet. It's on the honey-do list. Now, this one doesn't really have anything to do with leveling or anything like that, but it's just it's the coolest thing. This helps you. I'm glad you asked that. This is a. It helps you to find the studs in the wall. Stud finder, and what it does is it you hold down this thing and you work it along the wall until it turns red, and then you know that that's where you can put in a nail. So if you're hanging up things or something like that in a wall, that's how you find out what's behind it. Otherwise, if you have just sheetrock, that's not going to really hold anything. So you want to make sure you have one of these. Now it doesn't really have anything to do with this, but I thought it's the coolest thing to know that your pastor has a stud finder. All right, there you go. Now, the one thing I wanted to have here to show you today was a plumb line, and I didn't have one. Now, do you know what a plumb line is? You ever seen one? Basically, what it is, it's a string with a weight on it. And when you attach that string to something, the weight will hold it, and then it'll be straight, right? Gravity will factor into that. And so if you're building if you're putting in a wall with cement bricks and stuff like that, a plumb line helps you to keep it straight up and down. And otherwise, you might go this way, you might go this way. This helps you to visually see it. So when you're building something on a foundation, a plumb line is really great to have. And I don't have one because, well, why would I? Because I don't usually build foundations. In fact, remains, I don't even know why I have any of these because I don't really use them all anyway, but it's just nice to say that I have them in my repertoire, right? All right, why did I bring my tools that I never use here? Well, today you're going to hear a story from Amos, and Amos is talking with God about a plumb line, and the people of Israel, they haven't been following God's word correctly. They've been doing some things. They've been going against his word, against his way. And so one of the things that God said is, look, I'm going to put this plumb line in here, basically. Basically, it's his word. It's His commandments, His, what He's calling people to obey, right? And they have to measure up to that. They have to build their foundation so that it measures up to that plumb line. In other words, they have to follow His word. And that's what He's going to judge them on, whether or not they follow His word. Now, you have to remember, this is before Jesus came. So this helps them to kind of focus in the people of Israel. Do they focus in? Well, actually, they did not. And so the judgment came upon them. But for us, you know, we can use these tools to help us build foundations, keep them straight. We can also use the tools that God gave us to build faith lives to help keep us on the straight and narrow path. And those tools are Bible study, prayer, connection with other Christians. All those kinds of things help to keep us on straight and narrow. Okay? Make sense? Want me to bring these tools back sometime? No, I didn't think so. Okay. All right, let's say a word of prayer, shall we? Lord, thank You for helping us to see that there's a standard that we have to meet. Give us the opportunity to be able to meet it, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for coming up. If you want a treat, you can get one over there. Thank you, Davis. Friends, one of the joys, really, of being in a community of faith is when you can pause, give thanks to God for the blessings you've received, maybe even give thanks for those who have been part of your community for years. We have an opportunity to do both of those things this morning. Many of you may be aware that Lola Davis is moving to the St. Cloud area to be closer to her family. And so I'm going to go back there, and we're going to pray over Lola for her next adventure in life. And I know that she has some mixed feelings about leaving, but boy, to be next to family, that will take care of that pretty quickly. But it's always good. We can always invite you to come back. You can see this morning there are persons who have returned home to their spiritual home, and we always welcome them to come. So if you want to join with me back by Lola, we'll just pray over her. If you are comfortable with where you're at, if you just want to put your hand toward her as a way of we're praying for you, that would be fine. We'll do that. Are you ready? All right, friends, let's pray. Go ahead and pray, put your hands if you want to. I appreciate that. Heavenly Father, your servant Lola has been a part of this congregation for many years. And we thank you for her faithfulness. We thank you for her bright spirit. And these are just a few of the things that we will miss as she heads north to be closer to family. We pray for her transition. We pray for the new community that she's moving into. We pray that it would just be an easy and smooth move, that all of a sudden it's like she didn't even miss where she's at. We pray that this next adventure in her life would be one that's filled with joy and rejoicing as she's near her family. So we send her forth in your care and keeping, Heavenly Father. Bless her all of her days, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
And now, my friends, there's the more corporate prayer that we'll share together. Let's join together as we pray. Here we are again, Heavenly Father, and we're just grateful to be able to come to you in this space, to be able to praise your name, to pray to you, to celebrate with friends and be reunited with families, to reach out to one another in our celebrations and in our hurts. We're grateful, Lord, for this worship space, this holy sanctuary that for many, many years has given us such great joy in being able to come and worship you. We're grateful, Heavenly Father, for this warming weather. We know that it's helping everything to grow. We all have to mow our lawns a little bit more often than we thought we would. But we're grateful for the farmlands that seem to be growing as a result of the warm weather. We thank you for that. We pray for our nation. We pray for those who lead us. We pray for those who serve in the military. Ask for your safety in their return home. Most of all, Heavenly Father, we just are grateful for community of faith today that is faithful to you. All of these things we lift up to you as we think of those that we love but see no more. Persons that we've lost in the past week, we pray for Mark and for Myrtle, their families, that they would be strengthened. All of these things we lift up in your holy name as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray by saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's turn to number 2188, the family prayer song.
Come and fill our homes with your presence. You alone are worthy of our reverence. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We will serve the Lord. Lord, we vow to live holy, bowing our knees to you only. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We will serve.
Friends, I'll invite you to take your Quest Bible that's near you, and let's turn to page 1339. Going to find Amos chapter 7. This is a rather lengthy reading, and I'll invite you to follow your conscience if you want to read out loud or not. There's a couple of words in here that I remember one time when in one of the previous churches I was at, we had lay readers sharing the scripture lessons, and there was an Old Testament text that had about 7 or 8 or 9 different kings that just were too difficult to really pronounce their names. And so the reader at the time was very creative, said, and so King Nebuchadnezzar and all the other kings. So if that's if you need to have a moment there when we get to those names, just trust me, it's okay. We're going to start with chapter 7, and we're going to go verses 1 through 17. Let's listen to the text. This is what the sovereign Lord showed me. He was preparing swarms of locusts after the king's share had been harvested, and just as the late crops were coming up. When they had stripped the land clean, I cried out, "Sovereign Lord, forgive. How can Jacob survive? He is so small." So the Lord relented. "This will not happen," the Lord said. This is what the sovereign Lord showed me. The sovereign Lord was calling for judgment by fire. It dried up in the great deep and devoured the land. Then I cried out, "Sovereign Lord, I beg you, stop. How can Jacob survive? He is so small." So the Lord relented. "This will not happen either," the sovereign Lord said. This is what he showed me. The Lord was standing by a wall that had been built true to plumb with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord asked me, "What do you see, Amos?" "A plumb line," I replied. Then the Lord said, "Look, I am setting a plumb line among my people Israel. I will spare them no longer. The high places of Isaac will be destroyed, and the sanctuaries of Israel will be ruined. With my sword I will rise against the house of Jeroboam." Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, sent a message to Jeroboam, king of Israel. "Amos is raising a conspiracy against you in the very heart of Israel. The land cannot bear all his words. For this is what Amos is saying. Jeroboam will die by the sword, and Israel will surely go into exile away from their native land." Then Amaziah said to Amos, "Get out, you seer. Go back to the land of Judah. Earn your bread there and do your prophesying there. Don't prophesy anymore at Bethel, because this is the king's sanctuary and the temple of the kingdom." Amos answered Amaziah, "I was neither a prophet nor the son of a prophet, but I was a shepherd, and I also took care of sycamore fig trees. But the Lord took me from tending the flock and said to me, 'Go prophesy to my people Israel.' Now then, hear the word of the Lord. You say, 'Do not prophesy against Israel, and stop preaching against the descendants of Isaac.' Therefore, this is what the Lord says: Your wife will become a prostitute in the city, and your sons and daughters will fall by the sword. Your land will be measured and divided up, and you yourself will die in a pagan country. And Israel will surely go into exile away from their native land." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together. Lord, we hear this story from the Old Testament, and we may wonder how it measures up with the story of the gospel message of Jesus Christ, because it's a story of judgment. It's a story of sinfulness. It's a story of unfaithfulness. We pray, Lord, that whatever part of that fits our life today, that you would work with us on the mercy and grace that you've given us. I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my own heart would be acceptable to you, O God, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Friends, as we gather for worship today, we have many reasons that we come to places of worship that have become so familiar to us. We come to the place of worship that is our spiritual home. We see people that we love and care for. We see people that sometimes we're not so familiar with, and perhaps we aren't so sure about who they are, and yet we welcome them anyway, because after all, this is our spiritual home, and we may want it to become their spiritual home. We come to sing praises, to offer prayers to the Lord. We come to hear God's word, and we hope that we hear something that is relevant about how we're living our lives today. We listen to the music, hoping to be comforted, hoping to be inspired by it. We catch up with friends that we can laugh with, that we can cry with. We come to be inspired by the message that the pastor brings. At least we hope to be inspired, amen? We do. We celebrate the stories of how we're reaching out in the mission in the world, helping others to experience God's amazing grace. We might be hurting, and so we come for comfort and reassurance. We desire to raise our children in a spiritual home where they can learn, where they can grow in Christ. And we hope to hear how our world can make sense even when it seems like it's so out of control. Now, there may be other reasons that we have for coming to church other than these, just as there are many reasons for not coming to church. But I believe, as I think about it, in my 3 decades of being in the ministry, and by the way, the only thing that holds is just to be the ability just to say that. I've been in the ministry for 3 decades. It doesn't give me any more particular wisdom than anybody else. But I believe that we gather for a very specific reason. At our very heart of who we are, we gather because we are a faithful people. And we simply desire to worship and praise God with all of our heart. I think that's at the essence of what I have seen in those 3 decades. And it's a joy to be able to do so in a sanctuary that provides comfort for us. It surrounds us with so many precious memories as we think back over the years and all the saints that we knew that were here that graced the presence of First Church in the sanctuary or wherever it is that you worship now. When you think about the place where you come to worship, so many people have gone and come through those doors, and you have precious memories of all of them. You have moments when you come and you experience the peace and joy of just being in a holy space. So I ask you, what would your world be like if this space did not exist? Or any other worship space for that matter? It seems like there would be a void there of some sort. What would it be like? What would life be like if we could not come and worship at the temple, worship at the holy place, not be able to connect with families and friends, not be able to learn more about God's word, not be able to connect with our God in a very special way? Now, actually, that is the setting for today's message. The people of Israel were about to be exiled, not just from their homes, but exiled from the temple. The temple was their place, their holy space. They were about to be separated from that place. It was their spiritual home. And whether they knew it or not, whether they liked it or not, they were about to be separated from God. There were reasons for that. And one of those reasons is the primary lesson that we can learn from today. This story is really about how the sinful actions of humans can create problems. Now, that isn't anything that's new. Goodness, we know that. We understand that sin causes pain and separates us from God. We've experienced that all in our lifetime. And perhaps we don't hear that message often enough, maybe even from the pulpit. And I can tell you from that 30 years of personal experience why that is. It's not easy to stand up here and to talk about human sinfulness. It's not easy to speak about those kinds of things from the pulpit because it sounds uncomfortable. It sounds harsh. It sounds judgmental. And we flinch as we hear how God stands in judgment of our actions when we make mistakes and we engage in sinful behavior. And perhaps we don't want to be reminded of that, especially from the pulpit. That's why it's so hard to do that, to stand up here and to say, "You sinners!" But there it is. When we think about this particular text, there are some things that we have to be aware of, and not the least of which is that there are consequences when our behavior goes against what God has set down in His Word. There are consequences when our actions go against that Word. Now, I'm not telling you anything that you don't already know, amen? Y'all know that. We all get that. We all understand that part. What's really interesting is what happened in the book of Amos, in the story of Amos. The consequences for the people of Israel were all there. They all knew it. Plain for them to see. They were living recklessly without any responsibility for their actions. And the people of Amos' time, they wanted to live life as full as they could, as they understood it. They were not willing to pay the cost. They were willing to shift the blame. They were willing to shift the responsibility for their actions and minimize the responsibility for their actions to other people or other situations. So this storyline that comes from Amos gives us some things to think about. Because at the time, Israel seemed to be a flourishing nation. Everything appeared to be fine. Everything was going great on the surface. But the moral fiber of the nation somehow had evaporated. It wasn't there any longer. And as a prophet called by God, Amos sets forth a word of warning to the leaders of Israel. There's a standard that needs to be followed. A standard that's set by God and God alone, he told the people, Amos did. And he said, look at the plumb line as that standard. So Amos says to the leaders of Israel that God is ready to meter out this justice for its sinful moral decline. You see, there are consequences for actions that are sinful in nature that go against God's plan. And God, make no mistake about it here, God is the judge here. God is the one that Israel must answer to. So in the story, Amos sees this vision of the first judgment that God's going to send. He's going to send swarms of locusts to strip the crops from the land. There are consequences for actions against God. I'll say it again. Amos rallies the people of Israel. Sovereign Lord, forgive, he says. How can Jacob survive? He is so small. And Amos makes his plea, and God hears it. God relents and backs off on the locust idea, and he says, this won't happen. But justice still calls for some sort of punishment, some sort of retribution for the people falling away into sin. So God decided to send this roaring inferno across the land, so intense that it would turn the sea to vapor. Now, I don't know about you, but locust sounds a little better than this one. Anyway, Amos cries out to the Lord again. He says, Sovereign Lord, I beg you, stop. How can Jacob survive? He's so small. And the plea from Amos is heard once again by God, and God relents and said, this will not happen either. But the momentum turns right here. God says to Amos, he shows him this vision. He says, what do you see? And Amos says, I see a plumb line. And God responds with this twist in the divine plan. I'm setting this plumb line among my people Israel. I will spare them no longer. It's like drawing a line in the sand and saying, this is it. God wanted to see if the people would measure up. And if they continue to live against the plumb line, against the precepts that God has set, against the decrees that he has set, against the commandments that he has set, against his word that he has given them, then he would destroy the high places of Isaac, he would waste the sanctuaries, they would be ruined, and the sword of judgment would come. And there it is again, the consequences when people go against the word of God. Now Amos here is just the messenger. Amos delivers the truth as God follows through on the consequences. Amos was just a shepherd, minding his own business when God called him forth and said, go to prophesy to the people. And the prophecy was that no one will escape the judgment to be inflicted upon Israel. Israel, as well as the surrounding nations, would be in jeopardy if they would continue to disobey the laws of God. So where does that place us today? Now we know we've been given a Savior. Since this story happened in Amos, we have Jesus, and we're grateful for what Jesus gives to us. But we're still humans, the last time I looked. The challenge that we face in this world today is, even in the face of having a Lord and Savior who saves us from all of our sin, even in the face of that, why do we believe that we can act without impunity? In other words, why do we act in a way that shows that we do not believe our actions are going to have any negative consequences? Amos reminds us that the change of momentum is coming. There are negative actions, negative consequences for our actions that in one way or another are going to catch up with us. Now listen, it isn't that I'm trying to sound negative here today. I'm coming across that way, amen? I know. But consider the consequences when we think about the world that we live in today and how maybe it hasn't changed as much as we might think from Amos's time. When we think about the headlines that speak about sexual immorality, when we see poor parenting skills out there, destructive habits, disobedience, corporate and national sins of oppression, injustice, blurring of morality, unfair labor practices, racism, discrimination. And these are just a few of the challenges that we face as a society. And now, if any of those situations are hitting home for you, the truth is not intended to make you feel any less worthy, for all of us are children of God. But here is the hard truth. Let me just share a couple of dynamics with you. This is a broad brushstroke over the sea of humanity, and it's not meant to single out any one particular person. We cannot expect to become addicted to external forces, things like drugs or alcohol or gambling or other things, and not risk losing a future, not to speak only of maybe losing a spouse or losing our children or our home. Life has consequences. We cannot, for example, smoke cigarettes for a lifetime and not expect some form of health issues to fall upon us, and we die far too young. Life has consequences. Here's one I know that we can all agree to. We cannot expect to drive too fast on icy roads in here in Minnesota or in Iowa, wherever you drive, and not expect to get into an accident, because life has consequences. We cannot expect to stay out past our parents' curfew and hope we don't get caught and not expect to get grounded. Just as a postscript, I was ungrounded not 2 weeks later. Just saying. Life has consequences. We cannot expect to abuse our children and expect those children's lives not to be negatively impacted, because life has consequences. We cannot misinterpret God's holy word with societal pressures that are leading the way and expect our churches to be filled with persons who are looking for the truth, because life has consequences. There's a standard that God has set for us to measure up to. And it's like the plumb line: his word, his commands, his statutes, his decrees, his precepts. It's not any big surprise to us, because they're available for us to learn in God's word. Amen? And what on earth could ever make us think that we know better than misinterpreting this word, or ignoring this word, or even altering this word to fit our own needs or our own agenda? But of course, there is hope here. I know, you were about to say, aren't you just a harbinger of hope, Pastor Daren? Thank you very much for ruining my day. There is hope. There is always hope. When we repent, God promises restoration. But in the case even of Israel, they had to pay for the restoration. Fast forward to the end of Amos if you want to take a look at the chapters preceding what we just read today. After the price of admission had been paid, after Israel and the seven nations had paid, God promises restoration. We can be forgiven. We can experience redemption. We can experience restoration. We can experience return. Or maybe we could do what God is asking us to begin with. We can live faithfully right now. What a concept. We could live faithfully right now. The judgment is going to be repealed by Jesus on the cross. And we have to know that God's judgment, though, is intact for this world today. So we repent, we believe, because no one wants to live in jeopardy. Should we stumble, should we fail, should we fall away, there is always hope. Thank God there's grace and redemption when we return to the Lord. So my friends, the standard has been set. The plumb line draws that line that we need to follow. And if we've gone against that line, yes, there are consequences, but it's never too late to repent and return to faithfulness to God in order to escape the final judgment. Perhaps it's time for us as followers of Jesus Christ to measure up. Amen. Let's pray together. Lord, for your word, we do thank you. It challenges us, there's no question, because we're not perfect people. We make mistakes. I think the point is, we acknowledge them and we strive to do better. Forgive us, O God, and help us to live rightly with the plumb line helping us to measure up. We ask this in Jesus' holy name, all the children of God said, amen.
You've been listening to the podcast of the worship service from First United Methodist Church in Worthington, Minnesota. We hope that today's message has been a blessing to you, and we invite you to join with us in person every Sunday at 10:30 in the morning. For further information, check out our website at www.firstumcworthington.com. Thanks for listening.